Wormwood, even under Slubgob, you must have learned at college the routine technique of sexual temptation. And since, for us spirits, this topic is one of considerable tedium, even though it is necessary to our training, I will not bore you with it. However, on the larger issues involved, I think you have a great deal to learn. The enemy's demand on humans takes the form of a dilemma, either complete abstinence or unmitigated monogamy. Ever since our father's first great victory, we have made the former very difficult for them. The latter we've been closing up as a means of escape for the last few centuries. We have done this by using the poets and novelists to convince the humans that a curious, usually short-lived experience called being in love is the only reasonable grounds for a marriage, that marriage can, and ought to, render this excitement permanent, and that a marriage that does not do so is no longer binding. This idea is our parody of an idea that came from the enemy. The whole philosophy of hell rests on a recognition of the axiom that one thing is not another thing, specifically that one self is not another self. My good is my good, and your good is yours. What one gains, another loses. Even an inanimate object is what it is by excluding from the space it occupies all other things. If it expands, it does so by thrusting other things aside or absorbing them. A self does the same. In the animal world, this is done by eating. For us, it is done by the absorption of the freedom and will of another self into a stronger one. To be means to be in competition. Now, the enemy's philosophy is nothing more nor less than one continued attempt to evade this very obvious truth. He aims at a contradiction. Things are to be many, and yet somehow also one. The good of one self is to also be the good of another self. This impossibility he calls love, and this same monotonous panacea can be seen under all he does, and even all he is, or claims to be. Thus he is not content, even himself, to be a sheer arithmetical unity. He claims to be three as well as one, so that this nonsense about love can find a foothold in his own nature. In the other end of the scale, he introduces that obscene invention to nature called the organism, that perverts the very nature of competition from many parts and forces them to cooperate. His real motive for fixing upon sex as the means of reproduction among the humans is only too apparent from the use he has made of it. Sex might have been, from our perspective, quite innocent, just another way of a stronger self to prey upon a weaker, as it is among some spiders where the bride eats her groom at the end. But in humans, the enemy has gratuitously associated affection between the parties with sexual desire, and he has made the offspring dependent on the parents, and given the parents an impulse to support that offspring, thus producing the family, which is like an organism, only worse, because the members are more distinct, and yet united in a more conscious and responsible way. The whole thing turns out to be just another excuse to drag in love. Now comes the joke. The enemy called a married couple one flesh. He did not call them a happily married couple, or the couple who married because they were in love. But you can make the humans ignore that. You can even get them to ignore the fact that the man they called Paul did not confine it to married couples. Mere copulation for him meant one flesh. You can thus get the humans to accept as rhetorical eulogy of being in love what were in fact plain descriptions of the real meaning of sexual intercourse. The truth is that whenever a man lies with a woman, whether they like it or not, a transcendental relationship is set up between them which must be eternally enjoyed or eternally endured. From the true statement that this transcendental relationship was intended to produce, and if entered into obediently, too often will produce affection in the family, the humans can be made to infer that that blend of fear, affection, and desire which they call being in love is the only thing that makes a marriage happy or holy. This error is very easy to produce in the West, because so often being in love does precede a healthy marriage. Because young married couples are so often in love, just as new converts are so often full of religious fervor, people can be made to confuse both of these events with their feelings. In other words, humans are to be encouraged to view as the basis for marriage a highly colored and distorted version of something which the enemy really promises as a result. Two key advantages follow. In the first place, a human who does not have the gift of self-restraint can be deterred from seeking marriage as a solution, because they do not find themselves to be in love, and view any other basis for marriage as low and cynical. Oh yes, they think that. They view the intention of a partnership for loyalty and mutual help and the preservation of chastity and the transmission of life as something less than a storm of emotion. Do not neglect to make your man feel that he is disgusted by the way marriage services are performed. In the second place, any sexual infatuation whatsoever, so long as it intends marriage, will be viewed as love, and love will be held to excuse someone from all guilt, and to protect them from the consequences of marrying a heathen, a fool, or a wanton. But more of this in my next video.